Hello, I'm back with part two of my experience with Angelman syndrome, in particular my grandson. He's 32 years old now. This is 2018. He's 32 years old, and it's been well over 20 years that we got the diagnosis. And at the end of part one of my last video, I had mentioned I began to do research, and I did. Not really a whole lot of research was there, but not too much resource, I should say. And the doctor told me that. He told me I wouldn't find much. But I think today you can go on angelman.org, I believe, and you could probably get a lot more information. I think there's something based in Miami, Florida, as I remember. Things have changed over the years, so I'm sure there's more resources, there's websites, there's group on Facebook, I would imagine, things like that, where people come together and they kind of share their experiences with each other. But he's like you. He loves ice cream. He loves cakes. He loves candy. He loves all those things. Some things he can't have, of course. He's lactose intolerant. I don't know if that's part of the diagnosis, but that's what he has. He loves those things, but he can't have them all the time. But I try to set a little pace there for children to really look at him and know him. It occurred to me one day that with all the protection I was giving to Alex, that he was being really isolated in a way. He wasn't allowing people to really know who he was. The protection went just a little too far on my part. I didn't like people staring at him. I didn't like people wondering or even sometimes even asking questions about him. So I came to a very important decision. Persons getting to know Alex as a personality. Sometimes on first glance we determine or have a first impression of someone. We see a wheelchair and we get an impression, or the fact that he's waving his whole arm, the two of them, it gives you an impression. All the things that he would do, and he wouldn't speak. He's nonverbal, but he can get noisy. Doesn't mean that he no sound comes out of him. No speech. There's no speech. No words. And so I thought, I'm going to do something here that can get out of my comfort zone, because I was so protective with him. And getting out of my comfort zone means that I would make a video of him. Everyday activities, and I would just do a video and put it on YouTube, which I did. The very first one that I put on there was the one entitled Alex Has Angelman Syndrome, and I was really happy I did because of the comments I got, and it seemed to be useful to some people that were wondering about this syndrome and not knowing too much about it, but watching someone who actually was living it. So I never have regretted doing that. It kind of opened up Alex's personality, viewing him as a personality rather than just a person who had a syndrome. And especially when you don't know anything about the syndrome that he's carrying with him in life, you begin to wonder, and the person becomes to be very abnormal, and not anybody you want to get close to, don't know, don't understand it. Children and adults. Persons that were around, and we're around socially, a lot of persons that know him now on a personal basis, who, when they first met him, they felt the same way. So I did that, and I have not regretted doing that. It kind of opened everything up for me, too, where I became more let's put it this way. I wasn't so sensitive about any reaction that I got. Most of the people around me, that lived around me, now knew him as a personality rather than some stranger that had something wrong. I wanted to show you a picture of Alex. Turn this way, Mijo. Got home from school, from the program about 15 minutes ago. And this is Alex. Alex, can you look up here? Come on, Alex. Smile. Okay, he's fascinated by this. He's fascinated by the fact I have the camera turned toward him. he's acting a little bit more his normal right now. But this is Alex. This is who we've cared for since he was a little guy. And so now he's a big guy.
Do you remember the psychologist that I told you about that was the one who alerted me that I should get a genetic testing for Alex? Well, I had to come to his defense, or at least bring him up in the whole picture of finding out a new diagnosis when I went for an appointment, a neurology appointment. It was just a routine, and we went down to the hospital there in Sacramento. And so I'm waiting in the room with Alex when in comes the doctor. His name was Dr. Gosby. He has since retired, and I'm not sure where he's at now. But he came in, and he came in with a group of students. It was that kind of a hospital. And so he came in with these students, and med students, and he introduced me to, he introduced me as Alex's grandmother, and this is Alex. And Alex's grandmother is the one that discovered the diagnosis of Angelman syndrome in all my cerebral palsy patients, or at least most of them. Because you see what he did after I asked for the genetic testing, after Alex had been diagnosed with cerebral palsy, the doctor checked his other patients and found that they also had AS. So he was giving me the credit for having found this out. And I said, no, doctor, it wasn't me. It was a psychologist, Dr. So-and-so, and I forgot his name. It's been so many years ago. I didn't forget Dr. Gosby's name, but I forgot his the psychologist's name. I said it was him that brought it up to me. And boy, if you even know the story. I didn't tell him the story about, that I had mentioned here on a video that it was Phil Donahue, his program, that made me, that really moved me to make an appointment for a genetic test when I seen an Angelman syndrome child on his program. So that story... I found now that the fact that the doctor found Angelman syndrome in most of his cerebral palsy patient, as he told me, I find now that Angelman syndrome can be confused with cerebral palsy. There's very particular behaviors with Angelman syndrome kids. I don't know how these things have changed. I know that with the autism children, there's a spectrum. You know, you get high functioning, you get some nights of high functioning, and I'm taking care of an autistic person in my home who is Alex's cousin. I know that there's varying abilities with them, and so I don't know if that's still with Angelman syndrome. I don't know, it could apply to them too. I would think so. Some of the behaviors are, they love water. Alex, I think most AS kids love water. And things like plastic or anything that they could feel with their fingers. It could be a rubber glove, it could be a plastic baggie or something like that. It applies to Alex in particular here. So maybe other children don't react that way with those objects. But there's drooling, and he, in the picture I showed in this video a few minutes ago, he wasn't wearing a neckerchief, but he does have them. He has a bunch of them. We always have these hankies that go around the neck that look like a cowboy. He has that to catch any drooling or to make it easier to wipe his chin. So there's drooling, and his noise making, not speaking, but just making noises. He sometimes shows he's afraid, or he's agitated, or he's something frightened him, and so he makes these noises, and it alerts us. It alerts us. We don't answer to all of it, because sometimes he's just enjoying himself, listening to music or listening, watching a program on TV. He has his own TV in his room. But our communication is mostly scheduling. We know, okay, it's time to eat, it's time to go use the restroom, time for a shower, it's time for bed. All those things. If we have persons over, for the most part, when we include him, at some point he wants to leave the room and he wants to go to his room. He just doesn't tolerate all the noise. So that's the way we found it works with Alex. And as far as his walking, his gait is a little off, and he does not look to where he's walking, and he falls a lot. And so that's why we have the chair now, and he's when he goes to program on a daily basis, he's in his chair, and they do take him out to walk a little bit, and then he put him back in the chair. He's safer in that chair because he can wander off, and he'll step off of something or trip on something or run into something. So the chair is very necessary for him. Children walking on their own without a chair. Like I say, there's always varying degrees of disability with Angelman syndrome. So this has all worked out. We feel, well, we're on a little routine now with Alex, and he's got us trained, or we have him trained, I don't know, but it works out, and there's two of us taking care of him. So far, so good.